The next thing we need to talk about is classification of matter. Matter is anything that has mass and takes up space. So the first question in this flowchart is, can it be separated by a physical process? That begs the question, what is a physical process? Goes back to the definition of physical changes. So a physical process maintains the identity of the substance, it's easily reversible, and there's no bond breaking or bond forming in physical separation processes. Some examples would include filtration, decanting. So what is decanting? If you go to the beach and you fill up a bucket with sand and water, the sand is gonna sink to the bottom and you could decant or pour off the water on top. Sorting, what do I mean by that? If you have a bunch of beads and they're all different colors and you sort them by color into different piles, well, at the end of the day, it's still a bunch of beads. You haven't really changed the chemical makeup of anything. You've just rearranged everything. Crystallization, that's when you slowly cool something and cause crystals to form. Sometimes people do this to make rock candy. Boiling, and when I wrote that down, I was thinking about like desalination. If I wanted to separate salt from water, I would boil off the water and that would leave the salt behind. So all of these are examples of physical processes, and I'm sure you could think of a bunch more. And if the answer to that is yes, it can be separated by a physical process, then you're dealing with a mixture. Now, we can break down the mixture into two different categories as well. We need to ask ourselves this question. Does it have uniform composition? So, if something has uniform composition, if the answer to this is yes, then you're not gonna see any layers. So yes would imply no layers, no floaties. Everything looks the same throughout. So there's no difference from the bottom to the top. It's indistinguishable. If it has uniform composition like that, then we can classify it as homogeneous. So it's going to be a homogeneous mixture. If the answer is no, so we see some layers or we see different things floating around. If it has different states, so a glass of ice water doesn't have uniform composition because the ice floats to the top. Then we're dealing with a heterogeneous mixture. Sorry, my handwriting is kind of bad there. So G-E-N-E-O-U-S. Alrighty, so these things are on the side of mixtures. We can go in the opposite direction. So if we can't separate something by a physical process, then we're looking at a pure substance. And pure substances can be broken down into two categories. And what we have to ask ourselves is, can it be broken down by a chemical reaction? So this question right here. If the answer is yes, then we're looking at a compound. And we talked about what a compound is. A compound is something that's composed of two or more atoms. So compounds have formulas like carbon dioxide, so CO2, and we see how there's two or more things. Carbon dioxide, and that's gonna be a gas. Water is another great example of a compound, and that could be liquid, gas, solid, that could be a whole bunch of different things. Sodium chloride, table salt, another compound. Those things can be broken down by chemical processes. For instance, water, you're like, well, how can I break down water? If you apply an electric current to water, it's going to break down into hydrogen and oxygen, but you need electricity to do that. If the answer is no, if it's already as broken down as it's gonna get, you're looking at an element. And for this, I always recommend that students use their periodic tables. So if you see it on the periodic table, then it's an element. So some examples would be silver, or iron, just writing the symbols here, carbon. And I say, well, what about oxygen gas? Oxygen gas is a diatomic molecule. It always comes in groups of two, but it is elemental, but in a way it's a compound as well. So there's a couple of examples, are diatomic gases from the periodic table that I would accept either classification for. And there's quite a few actually diatomic gases, but we'll go over those when we look at the organization of the periodic table. Alrighty, in problem 5, we're asked to classify each of the following pure substances as elements or compounds. So we already know that we're on the left-hand side of this flowchart. So the first example is hydrogen. Hydrogen has the elemental symbol H. However, it doesn't exist like that. Hydrogen exists as H2, so it's diatomic. This is one of those tricky ones. It's definitely an element. Everyone would agree with that. But because it has two or more atoms, you could also classify it as a compound. However, the more important of the two classifications is the fact that it's an element. You should know that hydrogen is an element, even though it's a diatomic compound. Water. So the formula for water is H2O. Looking at the fact that it has multiple elements, and maybe I should even write that up here. Compounds have multiple elements. So because water has multiple elements, or it's composed of multiple elements, I'm going to classify it as a compound. Gold. So while you're first working out some of these problems, use your periodic table. You're going to find gold on the periodic table. Its symbol is Au. So it's a single element, and that makes it easy to classify if we can find it on the periodic table. Next is table salt. So table salt has the formula NaCl. It's also known as sodium chloride. Sodium is one type of element and chloride is another type of element. So we're going to classify this as a compound since it contains two different elements. So for problem 6, this W doesn't represent an element. Why I put that there is because a lot of times students will print out the lecture packets in black and white like I did. So what I meant by W2 is to simply remind myself and students of the fact that we have two white spheres connected. The W standing for white. Likewise over here with BR2. We have one black sphere, which represents one kind of element, attached to two red spheres. So the little two, it's called a subscript. That tells you how many of each element you're looking at. And again, these aren't element symbols. These are just the colors. In picture A, we have a whole bunch of diatomic elements, just W connected to W, white connected to white. So something that looks like this. So let's make a couple of notes here. One, this is diatomic. And two, it's pure because there's only one type of thing in this picture. And three, we're going to classify it as an element, because it's composed of a single thing. It's just all W's, all white spheres. In picture B, it looks like the carbon dioxide we saw in an earlier example. We have black with the two red spheres connected. So first off, we need to establish that this is pure. And sometimes students say, well, why is it pure? There's a bunch of different colors in there. Because we see this repeating pattern. We only see one type of molecule. It's this red, black, red pattern over and over again. So it's only one type of thing, even though that thing has multiple elements. So this is pure. However, we could imagine breaking down this pure thing, and we can maybe separate the black spheres from the red spheres. Because we can break it down and form new combinations or single elements, we're gonna call this a compound. The other big indication that it's a compound is because you have different colors or different elements, different letters or symbols. Alrighty, in question 7, we have a whole bunch of classification to do. In letter A, we have a pure compound because there's only one type of thing present in the picture, just a bunch of white spheres. It's also elemental in nature. And the way we know that it's an element is because we're looking at single atoms. Only elements exist as single atoms. In picture B, we have this molecule with a black center atom and four white atoms attached to that. And it repeats. So we have that same molecule over and over and over again. Again, just one type of thing going on in this picture. So B is definitely pure. However, within that one thing, we see multiple elements or multiple colors. So we know that we're looking at a compound. In letter C, we have some diatomic W2, so two white spheres connected. And then some of that same molecule that we just saw in letter B, this one. So we have two different kinds of things going on, right? And we can imagine, if I built all these, you could imagine sitting here and putting all of the diatomic white molecules or compounds in one pile, and then all of the larger ones in another pile. So we can physically separate these two types of things. So that makes it a mixture. We don't have to classify it any further, but again, we should feel confident we could label this BW4 as a compound. And the two white spheres represent some kind of diatomic element. Maybe oxygen gas or hydrogen gas. Last but not least, letter D. So we have four single white spheres. So when you see a four or any kind of number out front, remember, I just mentioned this number is called a subscript. A number out front is called a coefficient. The coefficient tells you how many there are, not how they're connected. So 1, 2, 3, 4. We got four white spheres and two black spheres, 1, 2. So the two out front doesn't tell us that they're connected. It's not diatomic. It just tells us how many we have. This is definitely a mixture because we could physically separate the white from the black. And not that they asked us, but we could also identify these things within the mixture as elements. So we have one type of element here and then another type of element there. So to go over your answers for number 8, seltzer water is a heterogeneous mixture. Whenever you have different phases, even if it's the same thing like ice water, it's going to be heterogeneous. The different phases have different densities, and they're not going to distribute themselves uniformly. There's going to be some stuff floating on top. So for instance, with the seltzer water, it's like soda or beer, all the gas collects on top. Sucrose. So they give us the formula for sucrose. If you have a formula, then that's your clue that it's a compound and it's pure. Argon gas. So you might ask yourself, can I write a formula for argon gas? Yeah, it's on the right-hand side of the periodic table. And it's actually just a single element. We don't even need a whole formula. It's just Ar would be its symbol. So since we can write argon gas as Ar, and then we could even put a G to stand for gas, we know that this is a pure element. Next one, red wine. Who knows what's in red wine? Maybe some alcohol, maybe some water, different flavors from the grapes or whatnot. So because it has so many different things, and I can't describe red wine using like a single formula like I did for the sucrose, I know that it's a mixture. The next question is, does it have uniform composition? This is always a great discussion point. It depends on the kind of wine that you've seen or drank over the years. I always thought wine was homogeneous. I guess, I don't know. I come from humble roots and, you know, boxed wine looks pretty homogeneous to me. But people have corrected me, students who know better, and said, well, if you get like aged wines, there's actually stuff on the bottom. There's some kind of sediment on the bottom that floats to the bottom. It's hard for me to write these questions, right? It depends on your experiences with some of these substances. So red wine is up for debate. It's definitely a mixture. So everyone should have put it was a mixture. And then depending on what kind of wine you're thinking about, it could either be homogeneous or heterogeneous. Ozone. So ozone protects us from UV radiation from the sun when it's in the higher levels of the atmosphere. The big takeaway here is that we have a formula. It's O3. So some students have said, well, is that an element? It's not. It is pure and it's a compound. The elemental form of oxygen, and I'll write this over here, is O2. So oxygen gas is how we expect to encounter elemental oxygen. Ozone is a different form and it's not the elemental form. It's a pure compound. Chicken noodle soup. So definitely a mixture, right? If you think about all the different things that are in some soup, and it doesn't have uniform composition, right? If you get one ladleful, right, it might have a lot of meat in it, and then the next ladleful might have just a bunch of broth. So it's heterogeneous because every serving has a different composition. And the gas inside a helium balloon, just the gas is HEG. And since we can look up the elemental symbol on the periodic table and describe it like that, I'm gonna call it a pure element.